Greetings. According to the Random House Dictionary, the term subclinical means pertaining to an early stage of a disease or having no noticeable clinical symptoms. When subclinical pertains to a disease having no influence on fertility, it is not really such a big deal. But what if? What if subclinical applies to a condition that prevents you from getting pregnant or causes a miscarriage or a stillbirth or a birth defect or autism? Is it serious enough in this case? Would you rather know about it in advance and try to do everything possible to prevent it, even though it is not yet noticeable to your family physician, gynecologist, or obstetrician? Since subclinical undernutrition does not show up on a routine physical exams or blood tests, it may remain under the radar of even the most attentive fertility specialist, even though it is a well-established medical fact that outright clinical undernutrition causes reproductive organs to reduce in size. So you tell me, what else can be more predictive and emblematic of infertility than the shrinking of your ovaries and testes? Do you really have to wait with a caliper in hand until this happens to you too? Well, I hope not. But how do you fix something that is not yet apparent, even to doctors? Good question. Without knowing what to look for, determining and overcoming non-specific subclinical conditions is like fighting a shadow. So to help you along, I will describe a range of the most common lifestyle factors associated with undernutrition, subclinical and clinical alike. In turn, you can determine if any of them applies to your particular lifestyle and circumstances, and then work on eliminating them. This approach does not cost you anything, is free of medical risks associated with assisted reproductive technologies, and just as importantly, shields your body from further decline and your future baby from non-genetic birth defects and developmental disorders. I also wish to remind you that getting pregnant is only a starting point. Holding on that pregnancy is even more challenging because depending on your age, between 20 and 70% of all pregnancies, natural and artificial alike, end up self-aborting shortly after conception. Considering just how high these odds are stacked against you, particularly as you get older, preventing miscarriage may be even more critical than conceiving. The financial, emotional, and health tolls of unresolved undernutrition are equally devastating after the pregnancy. Postpartum depression, disfiguring weight gain, irreversible bone disease, tooth loss, thinning hair, and precipitous aging are just a few of the outcomes of ignoring or missing this condition. So here we go, starting with maternal age. It is regretfully the number one cause of subclinical undernutrition. Our ability to assimilate nutrients from foods begin diminishing at about a 2% annual rate right around your 25th birthday. This condition parallels the reduction of human growth hormone levels and precipitates natural aging. Thus, if you are postponing your first pregnancy into your early to mid-30s, as it is now commonplace in the United States, nature has already pre-programmed you to fail. From this point on, and depending on your current age, you have several options. Option number one, simply increase your food intake by 2% each year starting at 25. That is in fact what most women do anyway, but only subconsciously and instinctively. Unfortunately, this approach causes inevitable weight gain, which may in fact erase all of your efforts because excess body fat produces too much estrogen and may disrupt fertility. Option number two, take weekly injections of human growth hormone at about $300 a shot. Unfortunately, this approach increases your risk of cancer, heart disease, and dementia after menopause. Option number three, ask a fertility clinic to harvest your egg while you are still young and keep them frozen in case you will not be able to conceive naturally at a later day. This hedge gives you 50 to 60% chance of having a baby at a combined cost of about $30,000 for harvesting, storing, and eventually completing in vitro procedure. And that is assuming you are lucky enough to get pregnant from the first try. Prior pregnancy and breastfeeding are obviously the number two cause of subclinical undernutrition, because delivering and nursing a baby is an immensely demanding process, particularly when it comes to minerals and microelements stored in your body. In bygone eras, ladies from well-to-do families outsourced breastfeeding to vet nurses, went to mineral water spas after each pregnancy to rest and replenish their bodies with minerals, and waited at least 2 to 3 years before trying to get pregnant again. But even if you aren't planning to get pregnant again anytime soon, leaving postpartum undernutrition unchecked may decimate your appearance, accelerate the onset of menopause, and cause degenerative bone diseases such as osteoporosis, osteoarthritis, and tooth loss. In turn, these changes may affect your self-image and marriage in many subtle and less subtle ways. Dealing with all of the above problems is also a costly enterprise. Just a single tooth implant and crown may cost you several thousand dollars. Imagine what it may cost to fix a mouthful. In terms of contributing to undernutrition and infertility, weight loss diets are firmly in third place for anyone over 30 years of age, and in first place for anyone under 30. That is because to be effective, a weight loss diet must restrict calories and inflict intentional undernutrition for a considerable length of time. Unfortunately, when a diet restricts calories from carbohydrates, it also limits the amount of minerals, microelements, and water-soluble vitamins in fruits, vegetables, and grains. Some of these micronutrients, such as iron, zinc, folate, and vitamin C, are essential for conception, pregnancy, and for prevention of birth defects. Similarly, when a diet restricts calories from proteins such as meats, fish, and seafood, it deprives the body of essential amino acids available primarily from these sources. This condition quickly cascades into digestive disorders that block the assimilation of micronutrients from other food groups and supplements. Adding insult to injury, when weight loss diets restrict fats, the intestines can't assimilate fat-soluble vitamins A, D, E, and K, and minerals such as calcium and magnesium. Low-fat diets may also cause a deficiency of essential fatty acids that protect your reproductive organs from inflammation, your scalp from hair loss, your face from wrinkles, your belly from stretch marks, and your buttocks from cellulite. Essential fatty acids are also paramount for fetus development and lactation. Finally, when all three food groups, carbohydrates, proteins, and fats, are reduced all at once, the damages go up exponentially, particularly if you are strong-willed enough to succeed at losing every last iota of body fat. What I just described should not really surprise anyone. It is a well-established fact that all extended weight loss diets, and by extension food disorders such as anorexia and bulimia, are also associated with reduced libido, irregular periods, or outright amenorrhea. As luck has it, most diets don't last long enough to cause clinical undernutrition or malnutrition. However, as time goes by, subclinical damage tends to accumulate even from brief, repetitive dieting. Well, we're out of time. I will continue describing additional causes of clinical and subclinical undernutrition in part 2. Meanwhile, to learn more about this and related subjects, please visit my website. In turn, I look forward to helping you and your spouse to overcome undernutrition, give birth to a healthy and happy child, protect your health, improve your quality of life, and enjoy the process.